This video is an introduction and overview to cover some of the basics about sacroiliac joint dysfunction. This is a very common problem that we see in the office that may be coming in for treatments that might be related to an injury. They may have had chronic low back pain. This might be after an injury from a certain activity, from bending, twisting. They may be patients that I've seen, particularly for pain management, and this might be someone who's coming in for acupuncture for low back pain. Not unusual that patients with this problem may not be getting 100% better with physical therapy, which is an extremely appropriate approach to getting stabilizing, strengthening to the lower spine and to the SI joint area. We'll go over the anatomy in a little bit. But often I'll get patients who may have had normal or fairly normal looking MRI imaging. They may have had a few multi-level disc bulges noted, no outright herniation, but not a lot that looks on the MRI imaging to be amiss. However, they continue to have regional pain that with biomechanical testing and palpation often is discovered to be coming from an unstable sacroiliac joint. And it might be the right side, it might be both sides. And I'll go over in the anatomy why this joint complex is quite massive and why those ligaments that stabilize the sacrum at the base of the lumbar spine needs to be situated, or else folks will have, with certain activities and movements, will continue to have low back pain that may not be actually coming from a disc, but from the SI joint or sacroiliac joint complex. The SI joint is stabilized by a very large complex of ligaments, and if any of these have been overstretched or injured, these may not show on an MRI. We usually find this on physical examination. Let's take a look at the anatomy with orientation of the lower lumbar spine. This large bone, the sacrum, and the tailbone here. This folks refer to as their hip joint. This is the pelvic bone, or the here I'm pointing to the iliac crest. And where these structures, all the vertebrae are sitting on top of, as you can see, where the fifth lumbar vertebra sits right atop the sacrum. Now, what we'll do next is I'm going to add in everything that just came up on the screen, this grayish material, grayish white material on this particular program demonstrates ligaments. Ligaments that cover this very large sacroiliac joint on either side. And also notice ligaments that are supporting the lumbar joints. These are capsules right in this area. These are the facet joint capsules. But all along this region here, this is all basically the makeup of the sacroiliac ligament facade that is connecting the sacrum to the pelvic bones or the innominate bones in order to keep this sacrum in line. Why in prolotherapy we don't just inject one position or one place is because of the extent of how large this joint is. So multiple injections are used in order to help treat the whole ligament length, as well as some of the side points. We'll see here, this is the iliolumbar ligament structure that is anchoring the lower lumbar L4, L5 to the innominate bone or pelvic bone. With all of these structures as considerations, we often choose multiple sites to doing a comprehensive lower back treatment when we're using prolotherapy, and particularly with the SI joint, which is as large as where I'm drawing with my pen tip. So just to give you an example of all these structures that we consider to be part of a comprehensive low back treatment when we're addressing SI joint ligament laxity or injury to the lower SI joint. It's not unusual for sacroiliac joint pain to sometimes be either misinterpreted or felt to be related to sciatica. In a diagram I'll show in a minute, the referral patterns from ligament structures can sometimes mimic sciatica, which may be coming from truly a nerve compression. But if there is true SI joint instability, structures, soft tissue structures, including the sciatic nerve bundle, will come under compression. This diagram is to point out the various referral patterns described by Dr. George Hackett when referring to specific ligaments when they are stimulated or if they've been injured or traumatized. The referral patterns are drawn out where, in specific, if there are areas of the sacroiliac joint or other structures that have been injured, patients will refer or describe some of their pain going into the buttock. They may experience pain going into the back or side of the thigh or back or side of the leg as an example. This sometimes could be misinterpreted as sciatica, and certainly in clinic we need to differentiate that, but noting that during injection treatments, often into the areas in question or those areas that have been injured, not uncommon that patients will have reproducible referral patterns similar to what they describe as part of their back pain problem. So simply a diagram to show the classic Hackett referral patterns that we use and often help to map out where some of the pain is being triggered from based on ligaments, not specifically nerves, but ligaments. Because of the large extent of ligaments involved in the SI joint for stabilizing, if any of those structures have been injured, traumatized, microscopically torn, people will continue to experience pain. So the point of this particular video is to go over the benefits of what prolotherapy can help with in this area using dextrose-based prolotherapy and or PRP, platelet-rich plasma. Sometimes these treatments are done with both solutions or one over the other, depending. And that decision is covered in other videos on my website. Because of the extent of how large this ligament structure is, multiple injections are typically used in an approach pioneered by Dr. Hackett. And we use a fairly common pattern into structures to help stabilize the whole ligament structure as well as the lower lumbar segments, usually beginning at about L3 or L4, and including ligaments that help support the lower lumbar spine as it makes contact with the sacrum. A side note about how prolotherapy does what prolotherapy does isn't by producing scar tissue. And this is an important concept in proliferative or regenerative joint therapies that place a specific injection solution into structures to create a microinflammation into those areas where the body responds with an inflammatory response and basically recruits fibroblasts, the cells that create new tissue. And what we find with tissue biopsy is once those areas have been treated, these are typically tendon and ligament structures, we will find after prolotherapy, we don't find tissue that looks like scar tissue, which biopsies of scar tissue looks like fibrillar material, but it doesn't have any cells in it. There's no cell nuclei. The same biopsies of the tissue after prolotherapy, we start seeing a recruitment of the normal cells being laid down to where it's nearly impossible to tell the tissue from its native original state compared to the tissue that's been now essentially replacing the damaged area with new cells, and hence the term regenerative solutions, basically regenerating tissue with a technique known as prolotherapy. the benefits, of course, are to improve someone's pain by minimizing the amount of instability. One produces a more stable platform for physical therapy efforts to do much more in the way of strengthening and balancing of the lower back. And as long as the instability is corrected, PT can usually make more advances with their PT strengthening. But of course, I think more importantly is how patients will improve their functional capacity, which is what pain management is really all about. Certainly, reducing pain is important, but if I can't get the patient back to a physical activity or a sport of choice, it may not really serve the patient's needs. So if I can get somebody back to the sport that they enjoy doing, provide more stabilization of the structure so they can walk, they can hike, they can run, and they can do their activities with less pain in addition, that's really the goal. And that's basically been shown with prolotherapy approaches combined with PT. So if we look at a study combining or utilizing prolotherapy versus introduction of only steroid injections, one can see in the following graph how prolotherapy lasts much longer in being able to produce a much longer, long-standing benefit compared to steroids, which tends to drop off after so many months. This graph plots out in a research paper showing the benefits over time in the course of months, how much improvement patients have received with prolotherapy compared to the drop-off effect that you see with steroid injections. The obvious benefit with prolotherapy providing a sustained reduction in pain relief as well as improvement with functional capacity, actually being able to do more things with less pain.